This says, the next rock legend to die, sadly, I think Shane McGowan, formerly of the Pogues. Well, he never did look well, did he? On the other hand, the laws of probability suggest it will be an ex-member of The Fall, being as there are about 60 of them, says Alexandra. Where's North from here?
Rock and roll!
Hampton. Matthew.
Oh, good evening. I hope you're well, matey. Enjoying the sound effects, as usual.
Yeah, who am I? Doesn't matter.
As I just mentioned to your
assistant
producer there.
Yeah.
I've come on air to defend the Queen. I'm a bit of a royalist anyway.
A bit of?
Yeah, kind of, yeah. And,
well, that's not, that's hardly a ringing endorsement, is it? A bit of, a kind of royalist.
Well, yeah, I don't want to go overboard, though.
Right. Let's not get out of control. Go ahead.
No. but you know, I mean, she's coped with the death of her husband. She never seeks any attention. She goes about her business on a quiet
She never basis. Seeks any attention. She shows up in from head to toe in canary yellow. What are you talking about?
Well, she's entitled to do what she likes. She's probably the most important person in England.
Well, she isn't. That would be Bodger.
Well, I'd defend him as well.
God.
Again, unnecessary criticism. I mean, whoever they had in charge of the country would get criticised in some way or other. And he's dealt with the COVID aspect.
Badly?
No, I think he's dealt with it very well.
Abysmal. The worst on earth.
Do you think so?
I know so.
Oh, I don't know. Maybe I've got it wrong. But from what I can sort of see or experience, he's dealt with it accordingly, and it's not an easy thing to deal with, is it? And,
well, other countries seem to have done it, have dealt with it considerably better than we have. I mean, fewer deaths, for instance.
There's a lot of inconsistencies. I have to say, in terms of the wearing of masks and stuff like that, and
they tell us to wear masks in public places, and then they all of them, like a memo went round, showed up in Westminster not wearing masks.
No, absolutely. But 1 minute you're told you don't need to wear a mask, and then I jumped on the tram yesterday to Wimbledon, and there's inspectors going on and asking you to put a mask on.
Did they?
Well, yeah. Then saying, unless you wear a mask, you could get fined or whatever. But then you can jump on anything other than transport for London and not wear a mask, and you won't get fined or threatened with a fine, as it were. It's just so many inconsistencies.
Yeah, nobody has any idea what they're supposed to be doing. It seems like that's the plan, to keep us all, on the edge of our seats, permanently unbalanced. I'm feeling quite unbalanced just thinking about it.
Yeah. All right, well, listen, I won't keep hearing on. Have a nice weekend.
Okay, thanks a lot, matey. 0345... 6060973. Did he actually call me matey?
Yes.
I believe he did, yeah. Acton. Hello, Andrew. Andrew. Hey, Andrew. Wakey, wakey. Andrew's been waiting a full 23 minutes and has passed out. He seems to have some sort of nasal blockage. Either that or these farmyard noises. Hello, Andrew. Is there nothing that will wake this man up? Nope, not that one. Wakey, wakey. I know it's been a hard day, but try to keep it together. Big bong coming up. You ready? Okay, time's up, I think. Oh, no. I hate it when it happens like that. Time's up on that call. How very disappointing. Rickmansworth. Hello, Keith.
Hello, Nick. Nick, you keep on going on about Bodge
going
having...
on?
Yes, about Bodge having 40% and Labour only 30% or something. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And I quite agree with you. It is sort of hopeless, but it's not going to change until New Labour get rid of their New Labour leader. When we get rid of New Labour leader and we get someone decent like Dawn Butler or Richard Bergen, then the difference between the leads between the poll will differ.
But we had a Jeremy Corbyn and he didn't do spectacularly well.
Yeah, Jeremy Corbyn yesterday. I'm talking about today. And today, until we get rid of New Labour, we're not going to make any progress. We've got to get rid of New Labour.
Yeah, but didn't New Labour lead Labour to their greatest period of victory in living memory? Or ever, in fact.
Yeah, but that's yesterday's news. I'm talking about today's and tomorrow's. Mm,
but doesn't what happened yesterday indicate what may happen in the future?
No, it doesn't.
What?
It doesn't because...
Well, I'm certainly glad that I didn't pay attention in history then.
People learn from their misfortune and their mistakes. Mm. And people are suffering, and they're going to suffer even more.
Yeah.
And they're not going to make any progress with New Labour. And until they get rid of New Labour and have a decent Labour leader like Bergen or Butler, we're not going to make any more progress. And Tories are going to laugh all the way to the polls.
So you think that the best way forward for the Labour Party is lurching to the left?
No, it's not left. I don't regard Bergen or Dawn Butler as lurching to the left.
Well, so what is it that they would offer? But what is it that they would offer that is not being offered at the moment?
Socialism. Democratic socialism is
all right,
what
put that into terms that we can understand.
Well, people understand that. I don't understand it. We know what New Labour is. We had enough of it, didn't we?
Well, tell me, what is it that you want that is not being offered?
Well, we want more council houses being built.
Right.
And we want nurses to get bigger wages.
Right.
You know, that's two things for you.
Okay, well, that's not going to happen under Starmer
and the rest of the New Labour
gang. Well, how do you know that?
Because I know what New Labour's like. And have you ever heard of Starmer using his Prime Minister's questions to plead for the nurses to get more salaries or for council houses to be built? No, because he's New Labour. New Labour is rubbish.
Well, the majority of the population in this country is sort of in the middle-ish. They're a little bit right-wing on some things, a little bit left-wing on others.
They don't want New Labour. They want a decent opposition, which is not going to be provided by New Labour Starmer.
Right.
And that's why he's so behind. I mean, you know, you go on about how, you know, it's amazing how the Tories are still 40%. Of course they are, because the opposition is so poor.
Well, don't you think that the actual reason why Bodger is ahead is that people have invested their hopes and dreams in a better life for the future because he promised them that with Brexit. They haven't had that glorious future delivered to them yet, so they're still putting their faith in him to do that.
I think they are.
They're still putting their faith in him to bring them that, and the alternative is too difficult to contemplate. Because the alternative would mean to admit that they've been had, and there is no sunny uplands.
No, there isn't. But Starmer isn't the answer to it.
Right. Well, I can't dispute that, because his popularity doesn't seem to be...
rubbish. He's New Labour. We've had New Labour. We had New Labour with Blair.
And how successful was Tony Blair?
Not successful at all.
Are you kidding me? Three times in a row.
That's because the press got behind New Tory. He wasn't Labour. He was New Tory.
Wait a minute. So it's dependent on who the press get behind.
Yes, it is.
Well, then forget about it, because the press are never going to get behind the Labour Party, regardless of who's in charge.
You're missing out one thing. The press are going to be foiled by the fact that the people are fed up with their circumstance and with their standard of living.
Listen, if the people were fed up with their circumstance, then Bodger Johnson's popularity ratings would have plummeted, and they haven't.
Bodger Johnson is at least not... Bodger Johnson at least gives people some sort of idea that they... You know, Brexit may work, and... You know, they're still...
This is exactly what I just said. That's why they're sticking with him, because he has promised them a better future, which they haven't experienced yet. And the alternative is to admit that they've been had, and there is no better future.
They won't realise they've been had.
So they are maintaining their faith in the bodge.
Until the standard of living drops.
It's dropped already.
No, it hasn't.
Of
not yet.
Course
not
it has.
Not enough.
Not enough.
And when people's standard of living really falls, then you'll find they'll be demanding not only a new leader, a new party.
No, they won't. I'll tell you what they'll do. They'll blame the European Union for being mean to us.
Or no, they won't. Yeah, no,
absolutely. They're doing it already. Or they'll blame Jeremy Corbyn for, oh, God, I don't know, existing.
They can't blame Jeremy Corbyn forever. He never got a chance, Jeremy Corbyn. How can they blame him for anything?
Well, how could they blame the European Union for being mean to us? We're the ones that instigated this departure. And what we apparently wanted was to leave, but to still be able to access all of the benefits of being in.
We shouldn't have campaigned to Brexit, but to Lexit. We leave politically, but not economically. Economically, we stay close to Europe because they're our best market. Our closest market.
Yeah, but you try telling that to the 40% of the people that support Boris Johnson.
It's difficult, but you do it better with a better leader. You won't do it with an anti-socialist who spends his time saying that everybody's anti-Semitic. I mean, that's ridiculous.
Right.
And that's
well,
why he'll fail.
He's not winning at the moment. That is true.
He won't win at all. Labour will not win any election with Starmer at the head.
I think what Starmer has to do is go into a coalition with the Lib Dems.
Too late for Starmer.
To go into a coalition with the Lib Dems and the Greenies.
But the Lib Dems are also Tories. There's only 12 of them, and they're Tories. They're not really a liberal in the real sense of the word. They're Tories, and the Greens aren't.
You have to work with what you've got. Keith, and what we have at the moment is the left vote is split at least three ways. The Greeners are now, they're not the 3 or 4% party anymore. They're tickling 8% in some places. So if they just do a coalition with the Lib Dems and the Greeners, then nirvana will ensue.
No chance. Absolutely no chance whatsoever. Until he becomes more accommodative of Corbyn left, he has no chance.
Wilsdon. Hello, Brian.
Hello.
Brian.
Hi. I was just trying to make a comment about the Afghanis who were working for our troops and for other kind of officials based in towns and cities in Afghanistan. I think that... they knew what they were doing, because compared to the other people who were employed in Afghanistan, they had much higher salaries. They went in it for the benefits, didn't they?
Yeah, well, part of the benefits that were sold to them was that we would take care of them when and
it,
if...
Did it actually say in the contract with them? Did it say so?
I've got no idea whether it was written down or not, but it had to be an assumption. That being the humane thing to do, Brian. Did they read the terms and conditions? I've got no idea. It doesn't matter whether it was written down or not. It's the humane thing to do. Swansea. Hello, Andrew.
Oh, hello there.
Hello there.
Evening, Nick. How are you?
Good, thanks.
I'd like to pick you up on a point you made a few moments ago.
Are we on speakerphone?
Oh, wait a minute. Should I close the door?
Oh, my God.
No, I'm not on speakerphone. I got the radio on. I just closed the door. Is that any better?
No.
No, should I walk away from my phone?
Yes.
Is that better?
That would be great. Can you walk away from the phone?
Is that better?
No.
I'm in a room that I'm doing out, and it's empty.
Oh, yeah. What colour are you painting it? Don't tell me. Magnolia. Yes! Guilty.
No, it's a Jaffa orange at the moment. I'm going to go into the kitchen. Is that better? And
I don't know. What colour's the kitchen?
It's puce.
Puce? Oh, well, then that sounds much nicer.
It is lovely, with the lights off, it's beautiful.
Yeah.
I'll close the door as well, so I don't get any light at all.
Right.
I just want to pick you up on a point you made a few moments ago about people's voting intentions.
Right.
And you said it was a kind of selfish act because of the hike in the national insurance. But I was
No. That's got nothing to do with it.
I thought you said it was because the national insurance had gone up and people were thinking that, you know, this is going to cost them more money, that kind of thing.
Oh, and hence the Labour Party are on top, excuse me, top now for the first time in a dog's age. Is that what you mean?
I was listening to one of your colleagues earlier this afternoon.
Oh, yeah.
And he had the guy from the Maori poll on there.
The Maori poll?
I can't remember his name. You see him on the TV. He's got glasses. He's always on the news, whatever.
Oh, the bloke on TV with the glasses. Yeah, yeah, I know. Yeah.
I'm sure you know what I'm talking about now. He does the Maori poll, and he was saying that the poll was taken about a week before the Conservative Party announced the rise in national insurance.
That may be true, but it wasn't a Maori poll, it was a YouGov poll.
All right, okay, well, that's the poll. Sorry, I didn't quite catch it all, but it was that poll.
No, but there may have been a Maori poll that he was talking about, but this is a YouGov poll that I'm talking about.
All right, I see, okay.
It's all becoming clear.
Yes, I know.
Yes.
Okay, in which case, I've totally wasted half an hour waiting to talk to you.
Well, that sounds like a super way to while away the day before you paint over orange and make it hopefully white-ish. White-ish, like a creamy white.
No, brilliant white.
A brilliant white. Yeah. Right, okay, well, that sounds lovely. It sounds a bit too white, to be honest. How much of the place are you going to paint brilliant white?
All of it.
All of it, right.
It's a very dark house.
Right, okay. Well, then I wish you all the best, and I feel your pain because I painted a 5-bedroom house, 5 coats, walls, ceilings, and wood.
So brilliant white.
Trade brilliant white. Yes.
Well, you've got more money than me, Nick, because...
No, I haven't.
I've only got 3 bedrooms.
Right.
One kitchen.
Mm-hmm.
And one very small living room, but a very large garden.
Oh, wow.
But we're going off the point.
Luxury.
I wanted to express some of the opinions of this guy forward. He said it was more to do with the fact that people from the South were feeling disenfranchised, the way the Conservative Party was going.
People in the South feel disenfranchised? What, the people with all the money, you mean?
Well, they say that they turn into the Liberal Democrats.
Yeah, not in any great number. They're about 10%.
Right. But also, he believes it was a fracturing of the right-wing vote between the Conservatives and the new incarnation of the Brexit Party run by Tice.
Right. But, you know, it doesn't really matter which pollster you talk to or listen to or what scenario it is that they paint about why the results are as they are. The Conservative Party are below Labour for the first time in absolutely ages. It coincided with tax going up, but it also, of course, coincided with, you know, 100,000, 130,000 dead people, the worst combination of death and economic hit of any major economy. We've had people talking about empty shelves and cancel Christmas and you ain't going to get no toys and driver shortages and restaurant worker shortages and shop worker shortages, and it just goes on and on and on, and people are pretending, they're tying themselves in knots to find some way of saying it's something other than Brexit. But maybe finally people are waking up. Look at the time. We haven't got a moment to lose. All right, thanks a lot, Andrew. Let's go to Barnett. Hello, Desi.
Hello, Nick.
Desi.
Nick. Oh, God. To a man I've loved him many years, but... I actually forgot what I was going to say now. Would you believe? But, no. Listen. The poor, as you said, were always the poor, and the rich... My mum said, the rich will always be rich, and the poor will always be poor.
Sounds about right. Listen to your mum.
My mum said to me one day when I was a wee boy, she goes, Nick, listen, please, don't cut me off, please, listen. I forgot, you know, I've actually as you would say, you're going all over the place.
Yeah.
But please listen, give me a chance. My mum said, this big man is walking, coming through on a horse, and this wee man is breaking stones, And the wee man look up to him and says, who won the war? Is it didn't matter who won the war, you'll still be a stormbreaker.
Right.
But apart from that, hello, Nick.
I'm going to move on, Desi. If you call back, make notes, because you're liable to forget. But thanks for the effort. Let's have a call in Middlesex. Steve.
Hello there.
Hello there.
Good show, by the way.
Thanks.
I want to speak about the media blaming lorry drivers for this flu vaccine.
Oh, yeah.
Because it's not down to the lorry drivers. It's all down to the government originally bringing out this IR35 in April.
Oh, yeah.
Because there was no problem before April with lorry drivers.
Well, that's not entirely true. Because it's not just the lorry drivers that miss all those excellent, hardworking Eastern Europeans that left because we insisted on it. But that is part of the problem.
Most of them left because they couldn't be self-employed anymore.
Well, I think most of them left because the country was yelling at them to get out.
Yeah, I don't think so. But why can't they transport all these flu vaccines in vans? There's plenty of white vans around.
But doesn't it have to come from a lorry to a van? I mean, isn't that the way it goes?
Well, not necessarily, no.
Well, yeah, it comes from a boat to a lorry to a van.
Does it?
Doesn't it?
Do they not make them in this country?
I've got absolutely no idea.
Yeah.
No, but I mean, generally, things come from larger vehicles to smaller ones. And the smaller ones show up at your house or place of business and so on. You know, most of the stuff that we consume comes in by boat. And boats are way too big to go down the high street. So they put the stuff on a lorry and then the lorry unloads it into a van, no?
Yeah, but they can still have vans pick all this stuff up.
Right, but who's going to drive the vans, though?
Well, there's plenty of white van drivers, isn't there?
Well, yeah, but they're busy doing plumbing and, like, you know, carpentry and stuff like that.
There's still loads of them around.
Yeah, too many. Yeah. I think we can agree on this, just way too many. And they're blooming abysmal drivers as well. That's correct too, isn't it? White van drivers.
No!
Yeah, you want to sort yourselves out. All right, thanks a lot, Steve. Let's have Hampshire, Oldham. Odidum. Odidum. Is that your name? Odidum. Odidum. No, wait a minute. He'll be yelling at the phone. I haven't put him up yet. One moment, please. Yes, Adam.
Hi, yeah. No, I was just thinking to your last caller about New Zealand. Now, I have a lot of family in New Zealand. And where everyone hailed New Zealand as the oracle for lockdowns and having few deaths.
Yeah.
And everything else like that. What we have to realise is the population of New Zealand and also the sparsity of New Zealand and the geopolitical side of that, it's just in the middle of nowhere. So no one really goes there other than if you retire or you want to leave
right.
as a kid.
Yeah.
Now, but the point is, at the end of the day, that Jacinda is going for this same as New, Australia are going for this whole COVID zero approach, which is just not possible. So they've been in this COVID zero approach for a very long time, yet they've managed to find cases after being in lockdown, not allowing anyone in, and yet they still have COVID cases.
Yeah.
Makes no sense. So what happens in... They're going to have to open up eventually. Now, we know with the Delta variant that you can be vaccinated and still catch it and still pass it on, et cetera, et cetera, double vaccinated.
Yeah.
What happens when they open up? They're going to get COVID at the end of the day.
Right. Maybe.
So,
yeah.
So where do they stand? So that cannot go with the zero COVID model they have.
Well, I think what they're trying to do, surely, is to get to the point at which they've all been vaccinated. They'll be relatively safe. And then, in due course, they'll be able to open up, opposed to our policy, which is, oh, I don't know, let's just make it up.
Well, no, you say that, but that's actually not true, because they are in the modern world, in the Western world, they are the second worst vaccinated nation.
Right. Well,
in terms of numbers.
Okay, well, why is that?
I don't know. You ask them. Why? So, okay. Put it this way. So during this lockdown, which they're having right now, when they go into stage four, they've actually closed the vaccination centres during this lockdown. So no one is allowed to get vaccinated.
Right. Okay, well, I didn't know that either, but I think the big number that jumps out at me is 26 deaths.
Yes, it is a big number. That's absolutely, of course it is. 26 deaths.
Yeah, as opposed to 150,000 deaths in this country.
5 million.
Yeah, 5 million, that's right. So if you extrapolate up, then you'd expect 300 to have died in this country.
No, but they also live in the middle of nowhere.
The 5 million people don't live in the middle of nowhere. They live in towns just like everywhere else on Earth.
Well, they do, but not quite as concentrated as we do in London. So how many people live in London? 9 million.
Yeah, but what's that got to do with it? Because the virus is everywhere. I mean, you could say the same about Sweden. People, at the beginning of this, Sweden had they went their own way. With their own 6 foot blonde Swedish way. And they didn't have the same number of deaths that we had. And people were constantly calling me up saying, oh, well, the reason for that is, as you've just described, Adam, they live in the middle of nowhere and they're very spread out. And they've got acres and acres between them. And it's not like here at all. But actually, it is exactly like here, because just like here and everywhere else on Earth, people congregate in towns.
Yes, absolutely. But what do you want to do about this? Do you want to live with this, or do you want to just
doesn't it occur to you that we have the worst of all worlds? I mean, we've had the worst lockdowns of any place in the world.
We also
have the worst death rates of practically anywhere else in the world. I mean, if you want a lesson on how not to do it, it's us.
Yes, but hang on, our death rates are based on the fact that we have the oldest population in Europe, and we also have the most.
That's not true. We do not have the oldest population in Europe.
Who does?
Well, Italy, I would imagine, or Greece, or one of these, like Portugal.
Is actual fact?
Huh?
I think we have the oldest population based
on that.
Yes.
You said it with certainty before. I thought that you were actually quoting statistics, but now you just think?
I am, but I need you to look that up. You've got
I'm going to do nothing of the sort. I just told you what I think. And it doesn't really matter one way or another. The age isn't significantly different in this country than it is anywhere else. We have old people and we have young people. Everywhere does. We don't just have old people in this country. It's just absolute nonsense. I mean, you can try and explain it away and give reasons why Boris Johnson and his cast of clowns haven't been an utter failure in this regard, but they have. Pretty much everything they turns to dust. They've got the Goldfinger in reverse. Torquay. Hello, Ross.
Hello. How are you?
Good, thanks.
Awesome. Just a quick question. So obviously a lot, millions of people saw the abhorrent scenes of Raheem Sterling, Bakary Sanya, getting called a monkey just because of the colour of their skin in the Hunger Game, England Hunger Game. Now, I'm wondering, do you think we've made a rod for our own back when there are comedians like Andrew Lawrence, for instance, who stated a fact like all the white people scored penalties in the Euro 21 England versus Italy final.
Who's Andrew Lawrence?
He's a comedian.
And is he?
Is this
one of his jokes?
Well, he's not very good.
Oh, right.
Yeah.
Well, I'm glad that you brought him up then.
Yeah.
What's your question?
So he said...
Yeah, never mind about that. What's your question?
So do you think there is a straight line between racism and getting and people being offended on other people's behalf that get people cancelled?
Wow, that's a very, very complicated question. Do you want to simplify that for me?
Okay, so Andrew Lawrence...
Yeah, never mind about him. Okay. What's your question?
how do you define it?
It.
So if someone says all the white people scored.
Yeah, you said that. What's your question?
My question to you is do you think that other people should be offended on
other people's
a particular
behalf?
Demographic's behalf?
No. There you are. You're welcome.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you for the question. No, I don't think that other people should be offended on other people's behalf if those people themselves aren't offended. What's it got to do with them? That guy definitely called the wrong show. Tottenham. Hello, Shirley.
Hello.
Shirley.
I've had the root canal done.
Yes.
But admit it was years ago, and I was always told, oh, they're painful.
Right. Yes.
So I thought, God, I didn't feel a thing.
Did they knock you out?
No. And when I said to his nurse, who was actually his wife, unfortunately, he retired long ago now, and she said to, I said, I thought it was supposed to hurt.
Yeah, so she
said,
punched you in the face.
Not if you've got a good dentist, it doesn't hurt.
Right.
And I tell you, I come out of there, he filled it.
Yeah.
I walked over the road, down another road, went to my friends and ate lunch.
Right, what did you have?
I think we must have had salad or a meat salad or something.
Oh, a meat salad.
Yes.
Yeah. Well, that sounds yummy. It's the way you described it. That.
But you've got a nice lot of friends, I hope. And ask amongst them if they know a very good dentist to do it. Right. And it was done on the NHS.
Oh, well, that I'll just go to the foot of our stairs. I can't believe it. So,
there you are.
Yeah, okay, there you are.
So you find a good one.
I certainly will do nothing of the sort. But thanks a lot, Shirley. appreciate the request. Odium, Hampshire. Hampshire.
Yes.
just in time. Yes, sir.
Sorry, am I on?
Yeah, it sounds like you.
So we were talking about...
Yes.
Hang on 2 seconds. I've got this radio going
through
my head.
Sure. Well, you're right. Okay. Cocaine running around my brain. A knife, a fork, a bottle and a cork. That's the way they spell New York. Right on.
Sorry, no. Yes. Yeah,
back with sound. Here we go.
Yes,
go ahead. Adam, are you all right?
No, I am fine, but I've got the radio going through my head. Hang on 2 seconds.
Have you turned the radio off?
Yeah, I know I'm trying.
Trying? So you certainly are. What was the question?
I gave up this question.
Right. Which question?
The one you were asking.
Which was?
Well, I thought it was about the whole US involvement.
Did you? Wow, you really do have voices in your head. I love the echoing silences, by the way. I mean, I drop a lot.
I'm loving what I'm hearing in my head right now from your producer.
Yeah, okay.
But, I've lived with... my brother-in-law was in Afghan. And he did 4 tours.
Yeah.
Of Afghan. And... No, he did do 4 tours of Afghan, and...
That's what I heard, yeah. And?
But I don't think this is about this. He never wanted to go there.
Right.
And nothing about this made sense, and he still maintained the fact that none of this made sense. And sorry, I've got this. I'm hearing my own self.
He's got voices in his head. Okay, well, take a couple of tablets. Just, you know, any that happen to be nearby. I recommend green ones. They're my favourite. Just take a couple of those and call me in the morning. When I won't be here. Thanks a lot, Adam, for whatever that was. Ealing. Hello, Paul.
Hi, how you doing?
Good, thanks.
I was listening to the guy talking about the, you know, the woman that got the, who's just got the new job.
Sharon Graham at Unite.
Sharon Graham of Unite. And in my firm, we don't have a Unite or anybody like that. We are just a bunch of workers that come in and we do our work. I mean, I've been with the firm for 13 years now, and I've had a pay rise of at least two or three times, and the most recent pay rise we had was about 3 months ago, and we got £10 a day.
Well, what's that in as a percentage?
It works out to about £200 a month, but £10 a day would be about... I don't know, if you work it out, I take home about £500 a week after tax and national insurance.
Mm. But can I just interject? You said that you've been working there for 13 years and you've had a pay rise three times.
At least.
Right, well, that's not very good. I mean, a pay rise once a year might be better to at least keep track with inflation, which means that you wouldn't actually have had a pay rise in real terms at all.
It's
quite possible that you're earning less in real terms now than you were for your efforts 13 years ago. Do you think that it's...
I think that's the same with a lot of people. I mean,
right,
I've spoken to people and they've said...
Is that the cause of not negotiating as a group, just waiting for the your employer, out of the goodness of their heart, to chuck you 10 pence?
No. It's a case of this way the job goes. I mean, no one's people talk about, oh, you can do with more money, but no one's actually been to, like, the boss or anything like that, because we're earning good money anyway. I mean, I'm an HGV driver.
Yeah, but it could be better, Paul. I mean, HGV, I'm tripping over my own tongue here. HGV drivers is what we're going to talk about in the next hour. So if I can just leave that topic for after the news, because there's all sorts of issues about that I want to talk about. But it does occur to me that the only way to get a decent wage out of most employers is to withdraw the labour in consort with every other person that works there. I mean, if you say, right, I'm not going to do my work anymore until you give me more money, then you will get fired. But if everybody goes out in support of each other, then it's much more likely that you'll get what you want. You'll get what perhaps you deserve. Because otherwise, they're unlikely to be generous. I mean, that's the history of labour relations. You don't get unless you ask, and even then you probably won't get, so you have to demand. Edgware, hello, Billy.
Hello, Nick, how are you doing?
I'm good, thanks.
So, Nick, two things. I was away for about 6 months.
Yeah, what did you do?
Well, I was building a hatchery.
How many dogs did you steal?
Zero. My grandma doesn't like dogs, so we don't have a dog in the house.
Right. So you were inside for 6 months.
Inside where?
That's what I'm saying.
Are you confused?
Me?
Anyway, I was away. When I came back, it looks like...
Once you'd been rehabilitated, yes.
No, mate. I travelled.
If you say so.
I do say so. Anyway,
debts to society, yes. What happened then?
It looked like a colony of vermin had taken over my house.
What?
Yeah.
A colony of vermin? Right. Why is that then?
Because I haven't up until now seen any rats in the house, but there are clues all over the house. Well, for example, they've chewed through my bed sheets, clothing, and they've spread, spaghetti all over the house. So I think they were stocking up for...
spaghetti. Right. But so, yeah. So let me just check if I've got this right. You've had rats in your kitchen?
Everywhere.
Billy, what are you going to do?
I called the exterminators. They came in, they couldn't find one rat.
Right, you called the exterminator.
Affirmative.
Yeah.
Yeah. And not a rat was in the house. So,
right.
I think one of your texters said that they could swim up the, the throne in a bathroom.
Right.
And I was suspecting that's where they came from. But it's horrible what they've done to the house, especially my clothing.
Well, I tell you what, because I had a rat problem in one of the places that I used to live in, and a bloke came around with a little dog. He said, I can see that there's some droppings over here and some evidence of... I'll go back and get my dog. And he came back with these two Jack Russells, and they went absolutely berserk. You've never seen anything like it in your life. They just sped around the place like they'd been wound up like robots, like automatons.
Correct.
And they dispatched the lot of them in about 10 seconds flat. They just came and deposited a pile of little rats. Rats come out of the drains. That's where they come out of. They live in the drains because they love it down there. It's like a holiday to a rat.
So does that mean that when I'm going away the next time, because I'm going to be traveling again?
Right, you're going to commit the same crime, get the same punishment, yes?
Yes. That means I have to block every openings in a house?
I don't know. Get yourself a couple of dogs.
Well, I can't afford to have a dog.
Right.
Barely around to walk them.
Yeah. But just don't leave any open sewers in the house.
Yeah, that's what I'm asking.
Yeah, well, I'm telling you.
All right. Well, right. You told me.
Right. There you are. You've been told. Now, you'll have to learn your lesson and not keep committing the same crime. Pretty Patel would be very upset. Thanks a lot, Billy. A recidivist, ladies and gentlemen. Perth. Hello, Mike.
Hi. I've been lying here patiently.
Sat there waiting.
Babbling on about Prince Charles. Listen,
yeah.
Nick, could I ask you? You'll soon run out of time right now. But listen, do you want to run out of time, or do you want to listen to what I want to say?
Well, I don't know. It depends. What do you want to say? You sound irate.
You sound like an irritated person,
Mike.
Actually, listen, it's just a favour. Could you tell me, because I'm sure you'll have the date, could you give me the date?
1972.
Yeah, I'm sure you'll have it.
73.
You're getting close.
1976.
It's actually the date of Greta and her Extinction Rebellion friends.
Mm-hmm.
When's the date of her next demonstration in
Monday.
China?
Monday!
Is it on Monday?
China,
her
did
next
you say?
Demonstration in China is on Monday.
She's not Chinese. She's European, Mike. Let's just stick with Europe. China you can't reach. They're untouchable.
Is your
position, Mike, that because China aren't doing anything, then nobody should
do
anything, we should just forget it?
You keep talking until it's out of time.
Yeah. Mike, okay, well, answer me this, Mike. Is your position that because
I'll just keep talking.
All right, well, I'll just fade you down then. Answer me this. Is your position... I don't need to ask, because I know what your position is, because you're one of these people that just flail their arms around because you have been told by a girl. And that really rubs you up the wrong way. You've been told the truth. And the truth is that we live a life out of balance. That's the truth. And that if we don't do something about it, then extreme weather will start affecting our lives. It has already. Look out the window, Mike. It's not just weather anymore, it's climate change. But for some reason, blokes like you just really can't stand it when you're told that your life is out of balance by a woman, yes, a girl specifically. Hate it. And so you get furiously angry. You were irate before I even said word one to you. And the opposition is, because China is polluting, then we should do nothing. So whatever problems the world face, we should always do nothing, because all 6 billion of us aren't acting as one. So let's just forget everything, shall we? It's a good job that there's not many more people like you. I mean, there's a significant number of people like you, Mike, but I think that as time goes on, as you shuffle off the conveyor belt of life, I think you're being replaced by other people who actually do give a damn. There's a little bit of hope, not much, but a bit. Stepney Green. Hello, Kirk.
Hello there.
Kirk.
Well, I'm amazed I've actually got on. I had 3 points I wanted to raise, really, addressing your concerns. Firstly, the one about the children. The thing that upset me about that is that the CDC have released saying that the percentage of people who are dying under the age of 20, this is something anybody can look up, is 99. The people of recovery from COVID is 99.something%.
This is
of recoveries of people of those ages. The CDC, it's written down.
In America?
This is, well, yes, but that's in America, but we assume the disease is the same all over.
Yeah.
So why would you want to vaccinate your child then? With a vaccine you don't know, it's not been proven, it's still classified as an experimental vaccine, and you would risk that with your child? No, I don't think so. Secondly, everybody's forgetting the Nuremberg Accord, which says you're not allowed to force people to have medications or vaccines. And actually, this is forcing us. If you're telling somebody you can't work, you're as good as forcing them.
But it's only forced if people refuse to do it. But doesn't logic prescribe that you do actually present yourself for a vaccine, because it's been proven to prevent illness, it's been proven to help avoid long COVID and protect the rest of society, surely.
Surely, I haven't seen this. I have not seen this proof. I mean, it doesn't make. I'm just a normal intelligent man, which thinks, okay, one minute you're boasting quite how many people you've managed to vaccine, and at the same point you're telling me the COVID is going up. It doesn't tally for
well,
me.
Well, we haven't had 100% of the people vaccinated.
No, we haven't.
Hang on, let me just finish. Wait a minute. And nor does a vaccine give you 100% protection.
No, I didn't say it. No, but I would expect to get something from it. Then what is the point of it? We're taking these vaccines. We're assuming to pretend. A vaccine, the whole point of the definition of a vaccine, according to the, what do you call these people? The patent office, who has to patent these things. They say one of the things it must do, and this is written down, is it must prevent you from catching it. This injection does not prevent you from catching it.
But it does, though. Just because the numbers are going up from what they were last week doesn't mean to say that the vaccine doesn't work, because the numbers are much less than they were at the peak before the vaccinations came in.
All I'm saying is, I understand that. I'm saying that I've also heard it from the people say that the vaccine people themselves say it does not stop you catching COVID. The vaccine does not stop you catching it.
And it might not stop you catching it, but what they're saying is that it would prevent you in large degree from becoming seriously ill with it. And to a certain extent, passing it on.
My point is, if you look at the definition of a vaccine, it's a simple thing. The definition of a vaccine says for it to be classified as a vaccine by the patent office, it must prevent you from catching that the thing that you're vaccinated against. Well, you can read it. Anybody can read it.
Okay, but we could dance around the definition of this or that. It seems indisputable that the vaccination does prevent people from getting ill. It stops as large a number as would without it going to hospital and becoming seriously ill. So let me ask you this.
Yeah.
If the government says, regardless of how you feel about it, you will be required to present a vaccine passport to go into a pub, a restaurant, a bar, then what are you going to do?
Well, I have no choice. I'm not a lawbreaker.
Right, so in that circumstance, you will get both vaccinations and the boosters as required,
No, I won't go in the club.
Oh, you won't go in the club? Right, okay.
No, I'm not taking this vaccine.
Right.
I mean, one minute I can't go in the... Right now I'm sad because I can't go and dance my salsa, but I put on my telly and I see the football pitch is absolutely full of people.
Yeah, but they that's outside and they have mitigating procedures for that. I mean, to some extent, well, they do have...
I was at Tottenham. It's completely rammed. They're pressed up against each other.
Right.
They may be outside, but come on, man.
Okay.
They're pressed up against each other.
People of a certain age, and I'm guessing you are one, aren't that interested in going to clubs. What I'm saying is, if it was required to maintain a normal life, to go to a bar or a pub or get on public transport or to even go to shops, how would you feel about that?
I think it's completely wrong because I feel I'm living in some sort of fascist state. You're forcing me to do something that, I'm sorry, that I cannot see the actual... I've not seen this proof. You're happy with the proof. I'm actually not happy with the proof. I'm not against the vaccine. People keep saying... I said, no, I'm not against. I said, I've taken vaccines in the past, but they have all complied with the standard rules of getting it tested properly during this particular time. If in 2 years or whatever, the vaccine is proved to be fine, I will take it.
Right.
I'm not taking it now because I'm not going to be experimented on.
Okay. I think medical professionals would say that this vaccine has gone through every test that would ordinarily have been given to a vaccine. In fact, it's been given more tests than you know, most medicines have to go through to get to market, and that its efficacy has been proven. That's what a medical professional, what most of them would say in response to that, to Kirk. Portsmouth. Hello, Pete.
Hi, Mick. You having trouble reading there? Or was it bad texting?
No, I think I read just fine.
Okay.
Are you having trouble speaking?
Yeah. I know, yeah, I forgot what I was going to say. Yeah, no, regarding the Taliban.
Yeah.
Take them out. Cluster bombs, whole lot. Just get them all out there. And the other thing was about Afghans coming over here. If we're going to have 20,000, what's the percentage of that is going to be of those who are going to be terrorists?
Well,
we've had it before when they come over the channel. We took them all in, and then one bloke done the speaking terribly. One of those guys did the London Bridge bombing.
Right. Well, it's unknowable. I mean, Patel did say that they would go through the strictest security checks. So presumably there's something in those checks that would highlight who is and is not a terrorist, potentially.
Well, not really, because one of them it wasn't a bombing. It was a knife attack on London Bridge. And we took him in good faith, and that's how he repaid us.
Right. So, but the answer then surely is to never allow anybody in for fear of what they are potentially capable of doing.
Yeah.
Right. Okay. Thanks, Pete. Tottenham. Hello, Shirley.
Hello, Nick. Thank you for taking my call.
Shirley.
Right. You say the working class vote for the Tory. Well, I'm old now, but I consider I'm working class, and I haven't voted for them since they got Margaret Thatcher out, and I would not, under any circumstances, vote for any of the parties in here at the moment, because none of them have got a good policy.
Yeah, but surely you could pick the least worst.
No, I wouldn't even pick the least worst.
But by picking none at all, I mean, if everybody that wasn't presented with their ideal choice just did nothing, then the minority, the extremist minority, would win forever.
Yeah, but why put a vote against something you don't believe in, don't like, or anything?
Well, sometimes you have to choose between two things that don't delight you, but one is not quite as objectionable as the other. No.
You don't know me. When I put my foot down, I won't do it.
Right. But you used to support the Conservative Party when Margaret Thatcher was in power.
I did, because I liked her. I liked her two policies, I'll tell you in a minute. I didn't like her for, but I liked her when she said no, she meant no. And I'm of the same ilk, but I didn't like her for telling the councils to set off council homes. They were built by the people, for the people, and also closing down all the mental institutions.
Right. But other than that, you think that Margaret Thatcher had the best interests of the working class?
I think she did, but not on those two points.
Right.
Because no money went back into the council to build new council homes. That's why there isn't any about.
Right. Okay, thanks, Shirley. It does exasperate me when people say that they don't want to, or they don't want to, or haven't voted for anybody because they haven't found a party that represents their interests 100%. I mean, I just find myself speechless. I don't know what to say other than just do it. Just pick one that you object to the least. Just pick that one. And in the fullness of time, perhaps something may come along that pleases you. But if you don't vote at all, just because the perfect option is not on the list, then you may end up with the least perfect. But maybe that's just me. Peterborough, hello, Maurice.
Nick, yes, well, hello. I have my... This is your NHS COVID pass, keep it safe document. And why are we obsessing on nightclubs? What percentage of the country attends nightclubs?
I'm glad you asked me that. I've got no idea.
Well, thank goodness for that, Nick, because you seem to have an absolute knowledge of everything else. So
you've never heard my show, have you?
At least we've nailed you on that.
Yes. It's a large number, a huge number. It must be massive.
Really? Not as many as go to pubs, for goodness sake. So
I'm not sure that's right. I mean, pubs are, I think they're closing at a rate of about, or before the pandemic, they were closing at a rate of about 10 a week.
Pubs, through my lifetime, have been the feeder source for nightclubs. Over the past, since I started, right. Over the past 60 years.
But it's not really a detail to get bogged down in. It doesn't really make any difference one way or the other.
And that is exactly why the government changes its mind in the way that the weather changes. When you go out in the morning and the sun is shining, you feel very, very happy. But when it starts to pour down with rain, you put your umbrella up, don't you, Nick?
If I remember to take one with me, I usually leave them at home in case they get wet.
Don't you get wet? Yeah. So it was an analogy.
Yeah, I'm not sure what it's got to do with what we're talking about, though, Maurice. We took a long, wending route around your thought. I'm not sure we actually got to the destination that you intended, but better luck next time. Candy Durham, hello, Sean.
Hi, Nick, son. How are you doing?
Good, thanks.
Nick, mate, before I start...
Yes?
Listen, for your listeners, right, I am not racist, right? But how there's 150,000 people dead in this country, right?
Yes.
There's 1,000 people dying a week, right? And yet they're still going to have 5,000 Afghanistanis come into this country.
Mm-hmm.
Now, we will never get rid of this Chinese plague if we're going to get strangers coming into the country.
Strangers come into the country every minute of every day. Every plane that comes into Heathrow and Gatwick and Luton and all points north, south, east and west is coming from. Are you kidding me? Millions of people come into this country on a yearly basis. So something like 20, 30 million people.
Yes, they do, but they don't get... Are they getting tested, mate?
Well,
there's no there's no mention of them getting tested. You know,
of them getting tested
when they come from Iraq.
Yeah.
Or from Afghanistan, sorry.
Right.
I haven't got a racist bone in my body, mate, but I'll tell you what it is. We cannot have people coming into this. It should have been done in the first place.
Sean, why do you assume that because you personally haven't been alerted to whether they'll be tested or not, that it's not going to happen?
Well, is it happening? That's what I'm asking.
Well, how the hell should I know? You would think that somebody would be all over it.
You can't see, and I don't think it is happening, though.
How do you know? What makes you think that it's not happening?
Is there somebody standing at the airport doing it, like?
I've got no idea, Sean. Let's assume that the government has got the wits about it to actually fashion something together.
They never have tested people coming into this country.
Well, not to any great extent. No, not to the extent that was required. That's right.
I mean, I feel so sorry for them at the end of the day.
But
at the end of the day...
Push them all back out to sea and let them drown.
No, no.
Yeah. Leave them at the airport. Just kill them at the airport in Afghanistan. Problem solved.
No, you're doing it the wrong way, man, because at the end of the day, you know, we kind of... People in this country got two jabs, you know what I mean? 41 million, right?
Mm-hmm.
But if another dose comes into the country, there's going to be another 50,000 to 100,000 dead before Christmas.
Right, that's got nothing to do with 5,000 people coming in from Afghanistan or 20,000 people. There's millions of people coming here on a daily basis. Well, not millions on a daily basis, but boatloads. Absolutely boatloads.
To save their lives.
Yeah.
You know, as well as our lives.
Right.
You know what I mean?
No.
You know what I mean? It works both ways, right. But at the end of the day, I think it's a... Barney Rubble and idiot should go to Iraq for a holder or go to Afghanistan for a holder.
Who's Barney Rubble?
Well, you know who... Johnson.
Oh.
Right? And you've got all your Flintstones at the front there.
Right.
They're all thick as out.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean?
Yeah. Did you vote for in the last general election?
I've never voted for anybody else.
Oh, my God. He's never voted for anybody.
What?
Guilty. I want you to sit in a corner, Sean, with a bag on your head and think about what you've not done. He's never voted for anybody. Oh, my God. You're not part of the solution, Sean. You're part of the problem. Here's calling Kings Lynn. Hello, Craig.
Good evening, Nick. How are you?
Good, thanks.
Good, good. I've got a bit of a question about the... just a little bit of a question.
Right. Can you give me a whole question?
I'll tell you what, I'll give you two or three. very quickly, has Ireland left the European Union?
Oh, what, is this a pop quiz now?
No. It's nothing to do with Eurovision Song Contest.
Right, just get to the point.
Well, guess what?
What?
There's serious chicken shortages in Ireland, in Southern Ireland. And they haven't left the European Union, unless you know something that I don't.
Yeah, I hadn't heard... Well, I hadn't heard that there were serious chicken shortages in Southern Ireland. I hadn't heard that. I hadn't read that anywhere. Yeah. Where did you get that information?
I got that from the Irish Times and the Irish Post. It's on their website, on their front page.
Is it?
Yes.
Well, where do they get their chicken from?
Well, they supposedly rear most of their chicken for Southern Ireland, in Southern Ireland, and from Europe.
I bet they get their chickens from us. Being as how most of the trade goes between us and them.
But there's another important point as well.
Mm-hmm.
Do you think you and I are an expert on workforces, possibly at Sandycroft, which is where most of the chickens are actually produced?
Would you think that the British Poultry Council know about poultry?
Well, shall I tell you quickly what Unite said?
Yes or no? Do you think the British Poultry Council know about poultry? Yes or no?
Well, No.
Well is not a yes or no. Yes or no? Do you think the British Poultry Council know about poultry?
Well, the data.
Your only options are yes or no, Craig.
Well
is not a yes or no. I'll ask you one more time. Do you think the British Poultry Council know about poultry?
Brexit is the...
See? I'm going to go ahead and say...
Yes.
Yeah, I'm going to go ahead and say yes. I think that the British Poultry Council probably do know about poultry. They said that the reason that you ain't going to get no chickens at Nando's or KFC or any of the rest of these places, and you might not get a turkey for Christmas, is because of Brexit. The biggest producers of chickens and turkeys in this country say that the reason that there's going to be shortages is because of Brexit. Everybody down the chain, from the very top to the very bottom, says that it's going to be about Brexit. But you go ahead and believe otherwise, Craig, because, you know, you're keeping the faith. Those sunny uplands were going to come into view any day now. Oh, it's painful. I don't want to talk about that anymore. I've talked about Brexit for about 5 years, and people made their mind up instantly on the spot. They thought, well, we'll get fewer foreigners. Nothing could possibly go wrong, and they will not be dissuaded from that opinion. You go ahead with yourself. See how that works out. Lambeth, hello, Daniel.
Hello, Nick.
Yes, sir.
Let me just first say that I'm an expert in UFOs and the aliens activity, like the Great Art of Crop Circle.
You're an expert on UFOs and alien activity.
Yes.
You may have called the wrong show. Go ahead. See how it goes.
No, recently the Pentagon was forced to release a report about UFOs.
Yeah, it was very, very boring. It contained nothing that we didn't know already. There was a little...
Did you read it?
Of course not. There was a little tic-tac that some pilots saw, and that was it. Dull.
No, I did read it, and the only thing they really say is nothing conclusive. It's not conclusive.
Exactly.
But the thing is, in the 90s, when I was like about 15, 16 years old, there was a huge buzz in my school.
There was a huge what?
Buzz.
A buzz. Right, was that that? Was that that laughing gas?
Much ado about nothing, basically. Ado. But everyone was saying there will be a huge revelation today in the news about aliens, and we were all...
disappointed, yeah.
Ultra excited. We come lunchtime, everyone watching news at lunchtime.
Mm-hmm.
Portuguese national television.
Yeah.
And they show a lab with corpses of aliens.
Corpses of aliens, right.
Quite impressive.
Yeah.
Quite impressive stuff. But the thing is...
Can I just check? Okay, are they still dead?
No, the tape is in VHS or better, but there's definitely that in the archive of the national television.
Right, well, nobody's got anything to play them on anymore. So, unfortunately, that evidence is lost.
No. It's in the archives of the Portuguese television. That's for sure, because they don't get lost.
Mm.
So that documentary is there.
Yeah. Oh, sure. Alien bodies. I only got shown in Portugal because it was just local information. Aliens from space had visited us and died, and then we cut them up, and this footage was only shown in Portugal. That makes complete sense.
No, the thing is, the search for extraterrestrial intelligence
Is
only
it's ongoing. Yes, let's hope that there's extraterrestrial intelligence, because we certainly ain't got none down here.
They actually find messages in this crop circles formations.
Sure. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Okay, well, you keep looking, Daniel, because the truth is out there. The thing about aliens is I heard that they mostly come out at night. Mostly. Walsall. Hello, Mick.
Hi, Nick. How are you?
All right, thanks.
That about this COVID passport. I think it's a bit like they've been trying to do for years, make us carry an ID card, but I'm not sure this is going to work, because I think the virus will sooner or later go airborne, which most do sooner or later. And if it goes airborne, not much point in anything then, is there?
It is airborne, Mick.
Is it airborne now?
Yeah.
I didn't know. I thought it... I know it's... They said it could go airborne.
No. That's how it's passed on. It's an airborne virus. Let's have a call in Wapping. Paul.
Oh, good evening, Nick.
Paul.
Yeah. The thing is that, like, you know, they should decriminalise it and just let these people who want to take it. You know, and when they're about 50 and they're, like, non-compos mentis,
mm-hmm.
you know, and I don't know which way is up. Well, yeah.
Execute them, kill them all. Yeah.
No, I don't mean that. Oh. But the point is, they're killing themselves.
Well, we're all killing ourselves one way or another. We're all drinking too much and, you know, we're eating too much and we're not getting exercise and, you know, all the rest of that.
There was, you might not know the group, but there was an old soul group called the Dramatics, and they had a track called The Devil Is Dope. And it says, while you're getting high, Lucifer is pulling you down lower. He'll make you a slave and put you in your grave, then close the door.
Right. So
that was one of the lyrics off the track.
Right. A band that I've never heard of talking about the devil.
No, they were an old soul band on the Stax label.
It doesn't matter. In the 70s. It doesn't really matter. I mean, you're putting them up as some sort of sage, like a band of wisdom in this regard, talking about the devil.
No, the track is called "The Devil Is Dope."
Yeah. But you keep saying that like it means something. So what?
Well, it's out to get your soul.
Said this band that no one's ever heard of.
Well, it's a vocal group. Yeah, but nobody's heard of them because nobody's turned on to like old soul music these days.
No one's turned on to old soul music these days. Well, maybe in Wapping, Paul, but everywhere else in the world.
Well, what I'm saying is that the song and the lyrics are profound to people who want to take drugs.
If the lyrics are as you've described, they're not profound at all. They're ridiculous and stupid. Talking about the
Not.
Lucifer is going to drag you down to hell if you smoke dope. What are you talking about?
Well, because you're going to die young.
Or not. Look at Keith Richards. He's had every drug that's ever been invented, and he's still going strong. He's about 150 years old.
Well, he's not 150 years old, but he ain't in the best of health, is he? I mean, he looks about 90.
Paul, he'll outlive you. If a nuclear holocaust rendered the world into a burning cinder, Keith Richards would emerge unscathed. Lucifer. I mean, what are you talking about? But anyway, thanks for the call, Paul. Appreciate it. Hereford. Hello, Alex.
Hi, Nick.
Alex.
Hello.
Yes, sir.
Hello. I was just about the experience at the airport. Similar to about going through customs. Mm-hmm. And I learnt the hard way on my ignorance about which countries are in the EU and which are not. I went to Gran Canaria on my return back from Gran Canaria with about £700 worth of cigarettes, not realising they're not actually, although they're owned by Spain, they're not actually part of the EU, although there were EU-subsidised farms on the island and such alike. So coming back through customs, I got flagged because I went through the EU channel at Gatwick.
Uh-oh.
And I regrettably lost everything. They didn't even give me the opportunity to keep what I was allowed to have. They took the lot.
£700
worth of cigarettes.
Oh my god. Oh, well, that's that, like these days, that's about what, 40 fags?
That's about right, yeah. Especially Marlboro.
Well, if you say so. Cool and smooth smoke. Yeah. All right, it gives you the ring of fresh breath confidence. That's what I heard. All right, thanks a lot, Alex. Don't make that mistake again. Northwich. Hello, James.
Hello, Nick. Nice to speak to you. First time I've spoken to you.
Oh, welcome along.
Yeah, I usually ring and Thomas Swarbit, but I've never voted Conservative, but I would like to stick up for Boris Johnson, if that's okay.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I think the vaccine rollout has been a massive success. I mean, I've had my vaccines, and I'm 53. If we have to have a booster, I'll be having that. I think that's been a massive success. I don't think you can blame Boris Johnson for Afghanistan. Biden decided to leave. That was his policy. So we had to leave as well because we couldn't have afforded to stay there on our own to defend the country.
No, we could have done. I mean, we spend something of the order of 40 or 50 billion pounds a year on the military. What on earth do we spend it on?
Well, I don't think we could stay there on his own without the Americans. And the other thing as well is, I mean, this thing in supermarkets, I mean, where I live, I mean, I've,
I mean, I have a YouTube channel, and I do a thing called Bargains of the Week once a week, and I've supermarkets where I live in Cheshire. I mean, they're full of food. I haven't seen any of them absolutely full of food. The garages are full of food, salad and everything.
James, I do
my channel, Bargains of the Week, once a week.
Right. Okay, but everything that you've said so far just sounds a bit like I'm all right, Jack.
Oh, no, I'm just saying. But the thing with the lorry drivers, I mean, we should have, as I said to you, the person who I spoke to, we should have trained up our own lorry drivers instead of relying on the EU nationals to do these jobs.
Mm. The problem with that, James, is, though, that people don't want to do that job.
Well, I mean, a friend of mine was a lorry driver. He's not anymore because he's got problems with his legs. But he was saying the problem is a lot of people don't want to do it because they're not getting paid enough.
Well, plus it's the lifestyle. I mean, did he have problems with his legs because he was sat in a cab for 10 hours
a day? Well, that's probably one of his issues. But right. He's like a brother to me. I mean, I was best man at his wedding. But he doesn't do that now. He's a security guard. But
yeah, I mean, that's the problem. That's why it's an aging workforce driving lorries, is because younger people see what it's what the job what constitutes that job, and they think, no, I'd rather do anything else. It's completely understandable. I mean, who would want to, in their workplace, have to pee in a bottle? I mean, it's just, no wonder people don't want to do it. And I think chucking them £1,000 extra as a signing on bonus isn't going to really help either. I think apart from anything else, the lorry driver issue is it might be a signing up for a job that is that has a definite shelf life. In other words, in 10 years' time, it wouldn't be remotely surprising if lorries were being driven by robots. But I get your point, James. The negative for things that have been mentioned on this show so far haven't affected you personally, so you're all for Boris. South Wales. Hello, James.
Hello, Nick. How are you doing?
Great, mate.
Well, Nick, I was just asking, do you think that Joe Biden's doing a steaming job with his handling of the Afghanistan crisis?
No, pretty awful.
Because when I looked at his ABC interview with George Papadopoulos, he didn't recall that the military told him that his plan was useless. He didn't recall he had troops in Syria. He didn't recall he didn't know how many troops the Afghanistanis had. And he didn't know that people were getting killed at the airport.
Right.
Because he was at Camp David.
Yeah, he was at Camp David, right.
Yeah, and he didn't...
Well, they don't have TVs at Camp David?
No, not so. Of course they have TVs. They got the clocks wrong, no, Nick? Photograph they put out, but there you go.
No, well, you mean Boris Johnson got the clock wrong when he was expressing his support. It was supposed to be 11 o'clock, I think, and so they took the picture. They forgot to wind his watch back.
Same as they did in Camp David, because the Russians and the British were 2 hours apart when they should be 3 hours apart, so we know that fake was a fake photograph. All I'm saying is that... I think President Trump would have handled this.
Oh, are you kidding me? It's Trump's deal that's the problem.
No. No, it's not. Trump
of course it is.
Trump had agreed to withdraw by May. He had a three-point plan. Biden delayed it till September.
Yeah.
Yeah, till September the 1st.
Right.
And he's got no plan. There's people getting killed at the airport.
What was his plan, James? His three-point plan. What was his huge and tremendous plan?
Well, ask President Biden, because he's the guy that ripped it up.
No, you just said it. He had a three-point plan.
No,
you said it very confidently. Well, so what was it?
For the evacuation of the United States citizens from all points of Afghanistan, not using Kabul Airport, but using Bagram Airport. But Joe Biden decided to go ahead with Kabul Airport instead of Bagram, because Bagram would have been easier to basically defend.
James, Trump fans absolutely slay me. I mean, you're just so desperate to try to prove that because nothing is perfect following Trump, that he was in some way visited upon us by God. He was the worst president probably in history, certainly in our lifetimes. The biggest liar that has probably ever run for or achieved office, Donald Trump. A huge, furious bag of malevolence that has allowed anybody that got into his orbit to get run over while he flew away free. Let's have Birmingham. Hello, Shirley.
Oh, hi, Nick.
Shirley.
Yeah, Hi. I was just going to mention about the lorry drivers. The problem is they've got a tax problem. If you remember Lorraine Kelly, Eamon Holmes and Gary Lineker, they had tax changes.
Lorraine Kelly?
Hello?
Yes.
Yeah, they weren't allowed to be self-employed. And for some perverse reason, the government put this on lorry drivers.
Right.
They're self-employed and they must find the gist of it, an employer to employ them.
No.
Horrible, or roughly speaking. No, they're not allowed to be self-employed.
Yeah, but they don't have to change their employment, but they just have to change the way that they present themselves to Her Majesty's revenue and taxes as being employed or not, or something. I don't know.
Yeah, but it's an absolute horror story because I think
Well, not really.
Yeah, but if you leave your job because of a tax problem, then that is a problem.
Yeah, but so don't leave your job then.
But if you can't work with the tax office, if Lorraine Kelly had problems and was up there.
Poor Lorraine.
Hello.
Yeah.
You know, if you can't work with the tax code they've given you.
Just do it then. But you can do. You just work with it. You pay a bit more tax.
No, but they're leaving in droves, so...
Yeah, but they're not leaving in droves because of that.
No, but that's adding to it.
Well, but you could say what was also adding to it is that they can't find a decent shower in the roadside in this country because the government has serially failed to provide the necessary facilities for lorry drivers. You could say that they're leaving in droves because they have to sleep in their cabs in some godforsaken lay-by somewhere, or the hours are too long, or you're just sitting driving a lorry all day. I mean, that can't be very much fun. I mean, look at the size of them. So how do they squeeze them through those tiny, windy streets? It's a mystery.
Why can't the government say, keep the tax you've got for the next couple of years? do you see what I mean? Why upset them? Yeah. They're leaving for reason. And also, they've got to do a test in the classroom. And one guy says, you have to pay £500. Well, why don't you waive the charge or pay a bit at a time?
But Shirley, these are all reasonable suggestions, but you're forgetting that you're not dealing with a reasonable regime. They're not remotely interested in the plight of the little people, not leprechauns.
No, because what also worries me, it's going to spill into the building industry.
Has done already. You can't get bricks and you can't get anyone to lay the bricks and you can't get plasterboard and you can't get tiles and you can't get cement and this, that and the other.
Yeah, and another thing with the DVLC, the driving licence people, why don't they say Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, we'll just do lorry driver stuff to get them through?
You know, making all of these tests available is one thing. Actually getting the number of people to take them, that's something else entirely. People don't want to do that job for many reasons. First of all, they don't think it pays very well. Now, a lot of companies have addressed that and they've increased the pay for, a newbie lorry driver. But it still isn't making much of a difference because people have already decided that they don't want to do it. Like people in this country, they don't want to be cleaners. They don't want to be security people. They don't want to be waiting staff. They don't want to be cooks. They don't want to be they don't want to be working in hotels. You know, all that service stuff. We just don't want to do it. And you're not going to turn people around just by waving a couple of grand in their face and saying, come and can you reconsider this career avenue? Of course they're not. Plus, it's by many accounts, an industry that's going to be dying shortly anyway, because your next lorry driver will be a robot.
Affirmative.
So why put all of that effort, put all of your eggs in a basket that is going to cease to exist within 10, 15 years?
But on the news, you may have heard somebody has died in the channel, in the water. We'll allow all those boat people to train.
Right.
Yeah.
Okay, good idea. You keep coming up with ideas, Shirley. In fact, do you want to run the government? Because I think you have more ideas than they do, in combination with the whole lot of them.
And you've also got prisoners, when you leave jail.
Oh, yeah, good idea. Prisoners. Let's let them all out and let them run amok on the roads.
And people without British citizenship, you know, waiting 5 years, blah, 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 they could do so much. But they really need to look at the DVLC and say, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, we will do nothing but process lorry drivers.
Yeah, but they, again, if you, they could say that, all right, but if there isn't a queue of potential lorry drivers around the block, then they're wasting their time, aren't they? It's getting people to want to do the job in the first place. And like picking turnips out the ground or strawberries off bushes, we don't want to do that either. You can't just wave a magic wand like the government is pretending to do and saying, you know, all of these jobs that the Eastern Europeans used to do because we didn't want to do and they didn't pay very well, we'll just get British people to do them. Well, no, you won't, because British people won't do them.
The government has got to sort it out, because
No, they don't. They don't have to sort anything out. The next general election is an absolute dog's age away, and Bodger, he's already said it. He's going to fight the next general election on Brexit. Oh my God, it's never going to end.
No, and it's all the stuff that's missing in the shop is the cheap stuff. So the dearer stuff, like for example, I went into Asda and they've got a pound apple juice that was there, but the 55p carton, not there.
Right. Well, this is what experts are saying now, that all that cheap, the cheaper stuff, which has a smaller profit margin on it, that they're going to prioritize the more expensive stuff because it makes them more. Of course they will. So the price of everything is about to go up, despite the fact that a certain Mr. Smug told us that it was going to go down.
You're better informed than I am. I don't know anything.
You remember he said it over and over again. We'll get cheaper food and cheaper clothes and cheaper this, that and the other. Like he knows anything about cheap anything, Mr. £500 million in the bank. And every single thing he said about that and probably every other issue he's uttered a word on was totally untrue.
But the public have got to get in touch with the government. Just get in touch with the government and say, just leave the lorry drivers on the tax they're on just for the next couple of years to
right.
get through.
Yeah, okay. Yeah, you write the letter up and I'll sign it. How's that sound, Shirley? Thanks a lot. Cheers, my dear. Let's have a call in Reading. Vincent. Vincent.
Yes.
Oh, just in time, just under the wire. Yes, Vincent.
Hi.
Would you like me to put you on hold? You don't seem ready.
Yeah, I'm ready.
Okay. This is you ready, is it?
This is me ready.
Okay. Go ahead.
Nothing's happening.
Well, yeah, but that's because we're waiting for you to say something.
Okay, something.
Oh, man, great. Yeah, okay, great. See, I should have gone with my gut instinct and got rid of him straight away.
Trying to connect you. Sorry to keep you waiting.
Yes, sir, Louis, I am sorry to keep you waiting. You're in Uxbridge.
Oh, hello, Nick. How are you?
Good, thanks.
The weather is going to take a turn for the worst after this heat spell. We'll have the set of autumnal features. Only work out Fahrenheit, is it add 30 or times by 2, something like that?
Yeah, add 13 and times by 2 is exactly right, yes. That is the mathematical formula.
Right, okay. Okay, well, you've watched Spitting Image before?
Have I ever watched Spitting Image before? Yes.
Yeah. Yeah, well, there's a new one now with Priti Patel. She's the vampire.
Right.
So I'm not sure what kind of weather a vampire's like. Is it hot weather, cold? I know they don't like garlic, but...
just as long as it's dark.
Right, okay. But she'll like the clocks going the way they
do. Don't bring that up. It's too soon. It's too early. Don't say it, Louis. I'm not prepared to let go of summer yet.
But it's getting dark now, at 8 o'clock. I'm driving home from work. It's starting to get dark on the M25. I don't
Louis,
know if I'm going for a tunnel.
Stop saying it.
Well, what else should I talk about then? You know, you were talking about rats. I saw a squirrel run across the A3 earlier on. That was something interesting.
Was it chasing a rat?
Must have been chasing a rat. Yeah.
Yeah, one of those cute, furry, cuddly rats. Yeah. Cuddle that, and that's the last thing you'll ever do. Thanks a lot, Louis, for whatever that was. Tooting. Hello, Jan.
Hi, Nick. Hi, Nick. I know, I'm not going to say how are you, because I know how you must be feeling, because I've got a similar problem to you, and I'm trying to find a solution to it. I'm not yet in that agonising pain, but I lost the crown and the parts of the tooth have broken away. Mm. Gold, it was a gold crown as well. And I'm having to find, it's very pricey, but I'm having to...
How much?
Well, no, look, I'm looking at dental plans with different insurance companies like Bupa.
Oh, yeah.
Go to the... I can send you, I don't know, a text or something mm-hmm. with details, but I've got a few remedies that I'm going to try, but I'm looking into dental insurance because I don't really want to lose the tooth, but it depends.
Jan, it's too late. If you've already got a problem, you can't get insurance for a problem that already exists.
You can.
No, you can't. It's a pre-existing...
Yes,
no, you can't. It is a pre-existing condition. It's like if you've got a flood, you can't go to an insurance company and say, can I buy an insurance in case I get flooded?
Oh, no,
and by the way,
insurance,
I've flooded.
For the teeth, you can get... Some of them, like Bupa, might do... Mm-hmm. You may have to wait some weeks. There's some that you've got to... There's a site I did a printout. I've got to do another one because I've left it... I've been neglected... like a lot of people not having dental treatment during the lockdown and this pandemic.
Right.
But which company, which do the reports on the best?
Which company?
Which, WHICH.
WHICH?
You know, which do reports on the best options for having, say, dental mm-hmm. dental plans.
Right. So which company is that?
Which? They do reports, specialist reports on, like, what is the best insurance, the dental
which one?
Plans,
Which one?
No, I mean, I've got an old one I did before the lockdowns, but I have to do it. But there's lots of them that do different options.
Yeah, but which one?
Oh, like Den Plan, Boots do one, Bupa do one, and you got to.
And how did you know about all of these?
Because I got it from the online. I googled it for www.which.co.uk. UK money insurance, dental insurance.
But which one?
And they do a whole lot.
Wait, who does?
No, you can get national, you can get NHS. A lot of private dentists do NHS. Because I mean, exactly the same problem as you. Except I'm not in agony. And you, Nick, you've got to take a lot of care. You can't take more than...
Jan,
tablets more than every 4 hours.
No, I don't think so. I think you can just, you pop them, snort them, whichever
way.
Of course. Nonsense.
And here's
never read the label. Which company did you say you could get all that information through?
They do report.
Who do?
You never seen those witch reports that do
which reports?
That's what the company's called. They
what's
do
the company actually, called?
Witch.
Thanks, Jan. Who's on first? Redbridge. Hello, Kishan.
Hi.
Kishan.
Hi, how are you?
Good, thanks.
So what are we talking about? Are we talking about the whole sort of transportation issues between Brexit and import, export, etc.?
Okay.
I originally called in to talk about houses, but I've been on so long, now we're talking about,
Dude, it's just a conversation. We can go anywhere we like. You want to talk about houses? Right. We can talk about teddy bears if you want.
Okay. Let's talk about the import-export process. So you talked about, you mentioned how everyone, people are talking about Brexit and people are, or people are talking about coronavirus affecting the issues that we're seeing right now. My view is that... It's a mixture of both. It's a mixture of coronavirus, it's a mixture of Brexit, it's a mixture of everything. But the problem is that we don't have when a supply is cut off from this country, when we're relying on import from other countries, especially China, when something like that is cut off, we are damaged quite severely economically because we don't have as much being produced in this country ourselves. We don't produce as much in our country. We're a service based.
Well, why is trade being cut off from China?
No, I know a lot of businesses that are seeing a lot of freight and a lot of issues in getting product from or manufacturing from overseas, especially China, because of coronavirus, predominantly because of coronavirus.
Right.
But that's
affecting everybody. I mean, every country on Earth has had coronavirus. But the problems that we have on top of that is that this entire country decided to be the first country in the world to negotiate a trade deal to make it more difficult to trade with our major partner rather than less difficult. No, nobody's ever done that apart from us.
Yeah, so there is this sort of one-upmanship against the East and the stronghold that we're trying to become an independent nation, and we're trying to come, you know, the whole West in itself is trying to become independent in that sense.
What do you mean? We are an independent nation. We've always been an independent nation. What are you talking about?
I don't mean independent nation. I don't mean dependent on imports such as what we're seeing from China, right? So we want to be able to create our own economy.
But that's insane. That's not how the modern world works. You get stuff made where they have either expertise or where the labor costs are low enough to make it to make the end product attractive enough to get people to buy it.
Yeah, absolutely. So we think we have a stronghold over the countries that do produce goods for us, right? So we think
it's the other way around. We do not have a stronghold on China. China's got a stronghold on us.
You know, I agree, right? But there is a naive view that we have a stronghold over them.
Right. Well, right. What kind of an idiot would think that?
Well, the Western economy, which is the reason why we've got ourselves into this position.
What position?
The position where we're reliant and dependent on them.
Well, we're reliant and dependent on wherever we get stuff that we're reliant and dependent on. I mean, we're reliant on the Middle East for oil. We're reliant on Singapore for the turbine blades. And we're reliant on China for a lot of cheap plastic crap that we buy.
So it's not just coronavirus and it's not just Brexit that we're facing these issues. There's other factors at play, right?
Yeah.
So such as these trade agreements.
Right, but everybody on Earth has had Brexit, and everybody on Earth is fighting to get those freight, the big boxes that stuff comes in on boats. You know, the big boxes on boats. Everybody's got those problems, but we on top have slathered on this extra layer of difficulties. as though we're not up to our eyeballs in difficulties enough. We've made it extra difficult to actually, you know, get our wend our way through all this. But thanks for that, Kishan. I gotta go. Folkestone. Hello, Nick.
Hello.
Yes,
hello,
sir.
Nick.
Go ahead.
Yes. Great to talk to you. Loved you throughout the last couple of years, really, since COVID began. Brilliant. Should have heard you earlier. Anyway, I want to talk about the cat.
Yes.
And the rat thing.
Right. Mm-hmm.
You mentioned a great big tail left with a stub on the end.
Oh, please.
So you can imagine the size of the thing that might have...
Whatever. Eaten it, yeah.
So our cat, which lives in an old oak sherry barrel in the garden, but we feed it biscuits and things...
Right.
It moved in with us when we came to our bungalow.
Okay.
Anyway, cut a long story short. We've been here a while, and it's done various things that cats do. It's a very lazy thing. But it brought this creature to us one night that it hooked out of the back fence. And it didn't just play with it. It brought it to us. But it ate it the other way round. It was just the head poking out the mouth and the two little paws either side.
Oh.
And it done that for some time, Nick, and it regurgitated it out.
Oh,
so it hadn't
just when
it,
I thought it couldn't
about.
Possibly get worse.
It does, though. I'm sorry. It does. So it regurgitated it out, played around with it a little bit more, jumping up and down, flicking it with its paws, mm-hmm. boxing it about. Done it the same way round again, tail first in, looked at us, and then it just gobbled it down as it looked at us, and the whole thing went in.
That's the worst thing I've ever heard, Nick.
Well, I'm glad to have contributed to your wonderful show on your Fridays and Saturdays. I do listen to you on a Sunday for the other stuff, but you're wonderful. So I hope that story adds to your collection of bizarre and ludicrous things that do happen.
All right. Okay. Thanks a lot, Nick. Don't ever call this show again. Isn't that awful?
Bye-bye.
Yeah, say goodbye. Oh, now I'm really feeling ill. Burton on Trent. Daniel.
Hi.
Daniel. Yes, Daniel.
Hello?
Yes, Daniel. Go ahead.
Yes. Right. Well, I'd just like to say that I think the problem we've got a shortage of drivers is because of the aging workforce.
Yes.
We've got, I think, an average age of 55.
Yeah.
And it's been said that by 2025 we're going to have a shortage of 250,000, let alone 100,000.
Yeah, same as bricklayers, actually. That's the same problem with bricklayers. They're all 55 years old.
Yeah. But I think also the problem that we have is, well, they said it's a shortage of drivers, but I don't think it's that. I think it's an organisation problem, and I don't think it's down to just, obviously, the drivers. I think it's down to, you know, the planners and the logistics companies and the markets and supermarkets taking the stuff. I mean, just a few weeks ago, I was working for a company and I was doing 80 hours a week.
Oh.
But 25 of those hours, I was sat around waiting, not being unloaded, just waiting to be unloaded.
Yeah.
And well, they don't.
They don't have the staff to unload the lorries. I mean, that's the problem. The problem all the way through it is the people who used to do the jobs that we don't want to do aren't here anymore, and it's affecting everything.
No, that's how it's been for years and years. As a truck driver, you'll go to a Tesco's or Asda or whatever. Mm. You'll go on a bay. You'll wait for 3 or 4 hours before they even touch your trailer, and that's not recent. And the drivers will get the blame from the transport officers because they haven't planned it right in the first place, but they can't blame themselves.
Right, well, okay, but if that is always been the case, then what we're experiencing now is completely different. It's not an extension of what you've just described. If you've just described the truth, and I have my doubts, I think Tesco's probably know their business quite well, but if that's your experience, then what we're what is happening to us now is over and above that by some margin.
It's only over and above that because they haven't got a large area of drivers that they can pull from the EU.
Right, exactly.
But I voted to leave because I knew that my wage would increase, and it has done.
Right.
Because it was being suppressed by the fact that supermarkets would happily get these drivers from elsewhere, and I've got nothing against anybody from anywhere coming into the country, but they're being taken advantage of by the big companies.
Everybody's being taken advantage of by big companies. We're all being used as slaves. it's called having a job, Daniel. Anyway, I've got to go, but thanks a lot, mate. Thank you for your service. Glasgow. Hello, Scott.
Yeah, hello, Nick. Just a few points before I get turfed off air. Javid said we didn't want to bring the vax pass in anyway. That's a lie. I mean, they've got multi-billion pound contracts have been signed. All the framework's there. It could be rolled out tomorrow. All that's required is our compliance. So that's a lie. Another one in a long list. You know, the reason why they've repealed it is because we pushed back. Now, don't let anyone think that people power can't change things, but I don't think it's going to be for long. But they've got this, but it's what they want. It's got nothing to do with the virus.
I wonder there is such a thing as people power, but in this case,
yes.
I wonder if it's specifically the people on the back benches behind the Prime Minister who've been yelling at him all week long because the polls have shown that he is not as popular as he'd like to think he is.
Well, again, that the backbenchers don't do anything without the people. So the people are pushing. The people have pushed back. I mean, me personally, another quick point as well. I mean, the French are certainly, it's just that the media here never show it for obvious reasons because, people, the idea will catch on. The French have been pushing back against this for a long time. As they push back against things all the time. It's just that people don't hear about it because it's not shown. The furlough, just abide by compliance, and it worked. But yeah, me personally, I was booked by, I won't obviously name the band, I won't name the festival. I was booked by a well-known band, a couple of well-known bands, to headline festivals. I was given the ultimatum a few months ago, get the jab, or, you know, we will have to drop you. I feel very strongly about this. So I was practically homeless a little while ago because I was losing money from a business I've set up myself. That's how strongly I feel about it. Right. Other people in my position feel strongly as well.
Right. You feel strongly that you won't get the vaccine?
It's not a vaccine, that's why. I mean, Nick, you said
come
earlier...
come on now, Scott, I can't get into conspiracy theories about what the vaccine is or isn't. That's not the issue. That's, I think we've covered that plenty. I'm not going to go down that road again, but thanks, Scott. Islington. Hello, Adam.
Hi, good evening, Nick. How are you, mate?
Good, thanks.
So, I just want to start off by saying I'm a really big fan of yours. I really am. I generally, 95% of the time, agree with most of what you say, but I strongly disagree on what it seems like. And forgive me, I've only been listening for the last 15, 20 minutes on my way home. The point around the gig economy and its impact on workers, I am an employment law consultant. I work in various, and I hope I can give you some insight. I work within various industry verticals, so hospitality, corporate, finance, legal, and I give legal advice in all those sectors. And what the gig economy has done, especially for young workers, and I will give you the opportunity to question me, but it gives a lot more flexibility for people to choose hours, when to work, when not to work. And there's been so many studies have been done where people have said, I prefer the flexibility than having a rigid long-term contract. Now, there is a negative when it comes to, for example, if you want a mortgage, you've got to be able to show stability in your role. I accept that, I acknowledge that. But I do think it's unfair, not by you, but just guest speakers coming in saying that, you know, workers' rights are being diminished or reduced. It really hasn't. It's a style of working, not forced upon anyone. It is here to stay. I'm going to be very honest with you, Nick. And it does work for both employer and employee. So on that front, I think it's a misconception to say that workers' rights and also companies generally do not break the law, generally speaking. I'm not saying it doesn't happen always. It does happen. But generally speaking, the UK's got really strong employment law, robust protocols and processes to protect employee rights. So that's my first point. The last point I was going to say was just in relation to your previous caller, I concur that I have heard the term lefty used as a slur word, and I'm a big sports fan, and I've often heard it from white working class uneducated men, and my view is that it comes from the fact that they, I hate using all these classification and expressions, but you know, the whole wokeism, the anti-wokeism, anti-me too, and because they're identifying that with the right wing parties or the right wing types, they're thinking, well, in that case then I identify with that element of politics, therefore I have to be anti-left. And it's sad and depressing because they're shooting themselves in the foot, and it's embarrassing. So I just wanted to give those perspective on that, and you know, I'm sure you're going to challenge me, so go for it.
Okay then. Now, you say that, you know, it's in the best interest of the workers to have, you know, the option of working hours and so on. And I'm sure that that's the case with some people. But for most people, they would far prefer the knowledge of how much they're going to work, not to sit at home waiting for a phone call to tell them that, yes, we want you in today. Can you come in the next half hour? They want to be able to tell you, they want to be able to know next week when they're working and the week after when they're working. People want surely a proper job that they can rely on, that the income doesn't go up and down with the week depending on which way the wind is blowing or the, you know, the attitude and the opinions and the whims of their management. That's not actually what people want. I mean, I know you can sort of bend yourself into a pretzel shape to try and convince yourself that people in the gig economy, that's really what they're after, is freedom not to say, okay, I'm not going to come in today. But that sort of lack of stability and not being able to get a mortgage is pretty important, but it's not the it of it. It's knowing whether you'll be able to afford your electricity bill, or can you afford to go to Tesco's this week? And that's not how people want to live, surely.
I will concede, you're right. I agree with you. However, and this is coming from anecdotal primary sources where I've actually asked people who I've questioned who are in that position of what you talk about. And on the flip side, they've also said, I like the fact that I can reject work if it's offered to me. Hand on heart, this is what I've been told. I like when I can choose if I want to do more work. Now, you are right about certainty. However, if you look at many parts of the UK, especially in the North and the Midlands, where, for example, there are Amazon warehouses, when I hear people say, oh, you know, they could be doing more, I'm sorry, but at least they're investing in these areas. At least there is work coming from them, because I'm not seeing UK-led manufacturers or the government, although one exception being they spent that 1 million or was it 100 million for Nissan to convince the Japanese to keep Nissan's plant. I don't see that happening widespread. So, and you could say, so what? You're saying that the, you know, it's a bad situation, so they should make the best of it. My answer to that, if you were going to ask me that, would be it's better than not having an income, you know, and they are conforming to the laws of this country.
Okay, but you can get away with some pretty unpleasant things while conforming to the laws of this country. So let's just leave that to one side. But I think it's a bit of a stretch to say that to somebody like, for instance, the Amazon Corporation is acting out of the goodness of their charitable hearts by opening one of their giant warehouses so that people, for the benefit of the locals, to work in for whatever it is, £10 an hour or some amount of money that they can't actually get by on. It's a bit of a stretch to suggest that they're doing it out of some sort of charitable...
Of course not, you're right. It's a commercial decision because maybe the rent is cheaper. My position remains, though, at least they're offering work. I'm sorry, I know it's not the best answer, and it's not a kind answer, and why should people have to put up with a lesser payroll? But one thing that your guest speaker, forgot what their name was, sorry, and when you guys were talking, one of the things that was omitted from the conversation is, and I mean this respectfully, I really do, surely you should be earning for what the role skill entails. When I speak to some people, and who are, I'm going to say it, socialist or hard left, who have said to me, a McDonald's worker should earn the same as me or should earn the same as a nurse. I'm sorry, why did that nurse, he or she, go to university, spend 4 years studying to earn the same as somebody who flips a burger?
Yeah, well, maybe you've picked the wrong example there. Nurses get paid probably about as much as somebody who does work flipping burgers in one of those restaurants.
I looked at the pay scale for London.
Yeah.
And it said, sorry to interrupt you, I looked at the pay scale for nurses in London, and the pay scale is between 21,000, right, and it does go up to 45,000. But how can somebody who works in a retail shop in the gig economy profess to be what they're asking to be paid would be the same as a professional worker? What's the point of studying, going to university?
Right, well, my answer to that is that a nurse isn't paid enough, and that
I agree with you,
and,
by the way,
and that should lift, and that the people who you've described, you know, working in the gig economy, their employment should lift as well. What seems to me to be indisputable is that, you know, a government that continually yells about the dangers of socialism is actually practicing socialism for the benefit of corporations, because corporations seem to be able to get away with paying people a pitifully small amount of money on which they can't live. So what happens is they are in receipt of universal credit or any of the other welfare payments.
To compensate. So,
exactly. Mm. So we, taxpayers, are subsidising international corporations who refuse to pay what they actually should be paying, a decent living wage, to the people that provide their profits for them. That seems to me to be a situation that's completely out of balance. Adam, good to talk to you. Thanks for that. Warrington. Hello, Kate.
Hi, Nick. How are you?
Good, thanks.
Good, good. I've got so many things to say now after that call from the guy in Southampton. The first thing I want to say is to the guy, Ben, who called, the Cockney guy. He said that he's just had a little baby, 5 months old.
Yeah.
And he said he wasn't the cleverest chap. Now, if there's one thing that bugs me, it's people who say that they're not clever. Everybody's clever. You've got a whole world at your fingertips. You know, don't ever put yourself down for thinking that you're not clever.
Yeah, he seemed pretty smart to me.
He was, absolutely, yeah. And the other thing is, the guy who you've just had on, the one from Southampton, said about being vaccinated and not wanting the unvaxxed in venues, whether it's pubs, clubs, bars, whatever.
Yeah.
So he called unvaccinated people stupid. Now, I'm unvaccinated. I don't intend on getting vaccinated, and I won't let my children get the vaccine. Not for now, until they can decide. As of now, I don't want them to get it.
Right.
And
well,
like you,
I have to ask. I have to ask why. Why not?
Personal research, I guess. The things that I've seen, I've heard, and I know people say, oh, you can't take, you know, everything that you see on the internet as being truth. Mm. I have a 14-year-old daughter, a 19-year-old daughter, who is old enough to make her own choice and decision, and a 10-year-old son. Now, I was looking at a report by Israel the other day. Now, they are the most vaccinated country in the whole world.
Yeah.
Their rates of myocarditis under... In young men under the age of 20 has absolutely skyrocketed.
I read that too. Yes, it was far higher than would be expected in the normal population.
Yes,
but it was even though that's true, it was still only in the low hundreds, wasn't it? For the I can't remember what the entire population number was that they investigated,
but it was
significantly higher than they would have expected in the normal circumstances.
Absolutely.
But what they didn't say...
Isn't one enough?
Well, perhaps, but what they didn't say is what the vaccination may have prevented those people from getting, which might have been worse than an inflammation of the heart, which is, I think, what myocarditis is.
Yes, it is, yeah. Inflammation of the tissue and the heart tissue.
Yeah.
I'd take a dose of COVID over myocarditis any day, especially under the age of 20,
right.
And especially if it was my child, absolutely.
Okay, but apart from your child, I'm interested in why you yourself haven't taken it.
Mainly due to side effects. I had a blood clot in 2015, which would stop me from getting the AstraZeneca. The Pfizer would be heart problems, and the reports that I've seen about people who are not getting... I don't want to use publicity as a word, but the recognition, if you like, that their loved one has died or had, I mean, dying, it's not a common side effect, but who have had, adverse reactions and side effects to the jabs.
Right.
You know, and it's women of my age. I'm 40. It's women of my age as well. You know, I've got two children and half of one to look after. And I couldn't risk it. I just couldn't risk it at the moment.
So suppose the government said, well, you know, it's policy now, 12 to 15-year-olds and anybody over the age of 12 must have a vaccination or you don't get to go to school. What then?
Well, I was looking at this as well the other day because I have a 14-year-old, like I say. Unless they're going to change human rights legislation, they're not able to make it mandatory. And they're not going to change a human rights law. And if they do, then something is, you know, something's amiss. I can't remember which part it was of the human rights legislation, but they would have to change it in order to make vaccines mandatory. And this is, people do not read enough. People don't look at legislation. People don't look at the actual laws that are passed. They pass laws when we're asleep. You know, they pass the law. They do, it's true. They did it in America the other day with the abortion law. Mm. They've done it in this country with the mandatory vaccines for care workers. You know, and people just go, oh, God, I'm going to have to take it now. That's it, or I'll lose my job. No, that's not it. If they make it mandatory, especially for NHS workers, then legal cases are going to absolutely skyrocket.
Right.
Because they can't do it. They have to change legislation and law, and they're not going to do that.
Well, OK, thanks, Kate. Shropshire, Beverly.
Hello?
Beverly.
Hello?
Yes, Beverly.
Hi.
Hello?
You know,
hello?
Toothache.
Yes.
Has anybody told you about oil of cloves?
Oil of cloves?
Yes.
Yes, I had a couple of pints of that earlier on. It didn't really do anything for me.
I don't think so.
I've stuck it on my tooth, yeah, but it didn't really do anything. It might have been oil of clothes, or it might have been eye wash. It was definitely one or the other.
You can get cloves.
Cloves.
And from the
chemist.
Well, the chemist or supermarket.
Oh,
and
supermarket.
What they are is they're right. A little
tube.
No, they're
bottle?
Like a little.
Gallon
a little
jug.
Stick, really.
It's a what?
That you.
A stick.
Yeah.
A stick.
You get loads of them in a. You know.
A stick.
Yeah.
What would I do with a stick?
You bite into it.
Oh no, I don't like the sound of that.
Yeah.
What does it taste like?
And it freezes.
It freezes.
It freezes the tooth.
Wow. How does it do that? Science.
You ask your partner. They're tiny little things.
What are?
That you stick in pork.
That you stick in pork?
Minute.
I most certainly will not. This has taken a horrible turn. So it's something you stick in pork. Is that what she said? I've got a vet on the phone. I wanted a dentist and I got a vet. It's something you stick in pork. What, like an apple? I have no idea what's going on this program. It's got away from me. Again. Again, it's got away from me.
Damn it!
Oh, well. Never mind. It's just a show. But apparently I need something you stick in pork.